Greetings and salutations to all you folks out there. It's been a while since we've taken a trip to the pyramids, but I think it is about time. We've got a 4v4 on here today. This is a standard 10-kilometer map size, great for encouraging good gameplay. It's got lots of avenues of access through everything, tons of raiding parties, good opportunities for air control to make a huge difference in the game, and you have to work as a coordinated team or you will lose. That is an assured fact. I do love playing on the pyramids, and some people disagree with me in my assessment of the map, but hey, I like it. It's my opinion. I'll run with it. Let's go ahead and introduce the players and we'll get started on this. We've got on the northern side, Scarecrow taking Cybern, Speed 2, the infamous, taking Brilliant Yellow Aeon. We've got Vex, not sure who that is, but I think that is a ring name. Taking UEF in the green, and then Seraphim for Kammer. So that means all four factions are represented on the north side. Looks like there is a slight imbalance favoring the north team, but this is relatively close. I think close enough that we'll get a good game out of it. On the south side, we have Jack Harrow taking Aeon in the rear slot, accompanied by Hellcat as Aeon in the front slot. Then we've got OK Puck in the right wing with UEF, and then Seraphim for Corwin on the left. No love for Cybern on the southern team, or left team, depending on how you look at the map. Maybe that's a test for your personality type. I do not know, and honestly do not care. Sometimes my brain just goes off on odd little rambles. So we've got a standard bit of land expansion up here. We've got a Hunter out from Scarecrow. He is going to be accompanied by a Mole, so hopefully he can find himself a nice, tasty engineer somewhere on the map. And we've got Land Scouts moving out everywhere else. And about the same from the southern team. Looks like this is going to be two Flares moving up. Sometimes that can be a good thing, sometimes not. On this map, I'm not entirely sure. It is a 50-50 toss-up whether or not you'll be able to actually kill something. Your best bet is going to be to run out to one of these mass extractors on the edges. Typically, there will be an engineer like this one moving up unaccompanied, other than the hunter that is going to be moving off to the side. So sometimes you can snag a kill there, and it is worth the time and effort to build that hunter, because this is a rather expansive map. It's a long ways to travel to your outside mass extractor. So if you kill that engineer off, that severely delays the expansion of your opponent, and that is always, always a good thing. So kudos to people who can pull it off. Speed pushing out some early interceptors, trying to hunt down that T1 bomber that is inevitably going to be headed across. Although it looks like transport's coming out first for Jack Hare, he is worried about grabbing his plateaus, snagging these mass extractors up and down the sides. But if he's not careful and doesn't get out an interceptor very quickly, he's going to lose that transport to this interceptor that is calmly pursuing that, well, it's not locked on yet. It is headed towards the base, not pursuing. Now it is. Headed for that transport. And there's the lock. Trying to micro that transport back and forth. If you can push the transport towards the interceptor as it's moving away, nope, two interceptors. You can actually screw with the firing pattern of the interceptor to the point where you can negate maybe 75% of the damage. But it usually only works versus one or two interceptors if they're coming from the same direction. Transport denied. Speed doing a very good job of getting that in there. And that means that there is going to be no transport to the mesas on either side. But it looks like Red is going to pick them up. That is kind of a steal from the air player, since the air player only has six mexes and does not get to expand outwards. But since the other transport is down, it doesn't matter. This team needs to get them and then hopefully drop on the outside edge. This needs to be moved. There we go. Micro around the factory so you're not shooting the factory, and plink plink away at that engineer. Cillin is, of course, the combination land scout lab for the Seraphim. Doesn't do a tremendous amount of damage, but certainly enough to kill an engineer. I think you can kill both of those engineers before that factory goes up. So that'll be a successful expansion denial. There's a race against time. There's a Mantis headed for it. Mantis may actually save the engineer. That's gonna be close. Oh no, 13 health. Two more shots, and the engineer finishes the factory. If he would have moved that Cellid earlier, he would have actually gotten that. So we've got a little bit of a slugging match going on down here. We got two air players in the back of the base here, and who is that? Jack Harrer doing his absolute level best to knock them off. But three interceptors in the air, that is going to be enough to challenge anything that gets thrown his way. And it looks like he's good to go. Now, speed, having delayed Jack Herrod to the point where he wasn't able to get his drop off and had a whole bunch of things that he had to sort through, speed is now going to take advantage of the time that he bought himself and drop the outside expansion, although there is a transport on the way from Jack Herrod. Jack Herrod did take the transport. Nope, he built his own. I'm sorry. Thought it was a handoff from another player. So he is going to be dropping four engineers on the outside edge. But Speed did push out a T1 bomber, so as soon as he sees those engineers land, he should be able to kill all of them in one pass, which would really suck. Speed's going to drop the other three engineers there just for the sake of having the extra build power. Going to get a radar online, land factory, mass extractor, and there's the ever-annoying Selen trying to deny this mass extractor with its very life and body. Alright, hello Walls. Good to see you again. This map, sometimes you can turtle effectively if you get the proper channel set up, and other times it just doesn't work at all. It just depends on... just depends on how creative your opponent can get. And right now I'm honestly completely amazed that these three mass extractors haven't been claimed. Scarecrow is getting an upgrade. That's going to be the T2 with which I imagine he will push up and build Cerberus turrets. There's also a huge amount of reclaim there. You always want to go for these reclaim spots because they all have rocks mixed in with them. There is a significant amount of reclaim on this map that you do not want to leave scattered about without taking advantage of it. Looks like we've got the T2 factory upgrade going down for Jack Herrod. Again, he has teching off of his measly six mexes. He should have dropped an engineer right there with that passing transport, and the transport's down to 100 health. He's going to drop. That was a nice little push from the side there. He is going to drop, but I don't think that he... Well, there's one engineer there. There's already a factory. That's the problem. When there's already a factory, you have a hard time getting a foothold because that thing can just start building T1 artillery and kill everything that you've got. And we'll see what unit comes out. If that's an engineer, I'll be extremely disappointed. And yes, it's an engineer. Well, he has a chance, as long as he remembers that he dropped those back there and actually starts building something. Got a T1 bomber coming out as well. If that can kill off the build power, that is always a good thing. And point defense. Hopefully, tanks are not in the immediate plans of Jack Herrod. Alright, looks like the map has settled down a little bit. There is a small run by here. No, go back. Kill it. Don't let it... That is a perfect kill! 98% of a T2 mass extractor paid for and killed by two T1 tanks with very little effort. That is the most painful thing that you can possibly have happen to you. It just makes you want to die a little inside. Because it was so close, and you spent 1,000 plus mass on... Well, no, hold on. The upgrade is 900, I think. Let me take a look-see here. Do you have a T1 mass extractor? There we go. 900. Yeah. Okay, I was right the second time. 900 mass invested. Around 20 tanks worth of mass or so. 20, 25 tanks. So... Yeah, that is painful. Is it 18 tanks? I am getting all of my math things confused. Alright, let's see if I can find out here. Let's go to Hellcat, and bam. I wanted to show you this. It is 18 tanks for a T2 mass extractor upgrade. Nice little battle up here. I wanted to give credit to Softly. He made a mod. You can see I have an extra little box up here right next to the reclaim window with the same style. And it gives you the mass value of any selected units. So you can compare armies, and it's very, very handy. So you can select any unit and see exactly what's going on. So that is 406 mass worth of tanks. And then we can go to Scarecrow with his opposing force, and you know he's pulling 1,000 mass worth of tanks. So if you're looking at two sides of a fight, or if you're just playing in your own game, and you want to see how much mass you have in certain areas of the map, or how much a building is worth strictly at a glance without actually having to click through to the build menu and look up the price yourself. All you gotta do is dink, and there's your mass and power value. Really, really cool tool. I was very impressed with it. So search softly in the mod vault. It's a UI mod. You can turn it on, and it does wonders. All right, Corwin bringing his ACU over to the left along with the T1 bomber, trying to deny this run-by. That was an engagement that did not go very well for him up here. He lost that, lost all of his tanks, and now we have a run-by on our hands that is going to probably make it all the way back into the base, which is going to be terrifyingly bad. And there was an attempted run-by here, which did not succeed. We have a TAC launcher, which has not fired a TAC yet. Let's see if they have it scouted. That would be a yes. They do have it scouted, so hopefully they will start building TMD very quickly. There's a couple right there. These Mantis, ugh, killed off the T2 engineers, which is really bad. There's an Ilshava that came up, so it'll be able to deal with these pretty easily, but that will stall the T2 power, which is not something that you want to have happening. Mantis are dealt with, but that's a fairly serious setback to Corwin. And it looks like Scarecrow is going to be able to move up and take that mass field and the mass extractor. So kudos to him. He is going to have a huge reclaim and map control advantage. Let's take a look here. Scarecrow reclaiming almost 10k, pulling 67 mass per tick, 72 somewhere around in there, depending on the reclaim at that exact tick. Speed slightly lower, 49 mass, but he does have a little bit more power, and he's reclaimed 12k. Very impressive. Hellcat with 13. And let's zip on down the line here. Awesome use of the T1 bombers, even as kamikaze units. They're worth it as long as you can kill some engineers or do some damage to some tanks. Throw them away by all means. 6k for Vex, 6 and 5 and 4. And you can see that there's a pretty much direct relation between the amount of reclaim and your place on the scoreboard. That is not a coincidence. As long as you maintain good reclaim practices, you will be ahead of most of the players of Supreme Commander, because reclaim is crucial, and I cannot emphasize that enough. Vexy has a T2 commander, and he's assisting this TAC launcher. He's already got one in the bank, and he is mass stalling very hard. TACs do not build if you're mass stalling, so you need to back off of your other building projects if you're going to build a TAC launcher, because that's a significant mass investment at this phase of the game. So you don't want to be spending 800 mass on something and then not using it to its full potential. And you can see by the time he actually launched a TAC missile, we got TMD, we got TMD, and no TMD over here. Hopefully he fires at red somewhere. And TAC headed for... I desperately hope that was not directly headed for the ACU. Bad targeting choice, Vexy. I am disappointed. If you can't kill it, you can't even kill it in two shots, and there's no way you'd land two single TACs on him. That was a complete waste of a TAC missile that could have been landed back here on one of these T2 mechs, or preferably this one that is halfway to a T3 again, killing off a mass extractor that's had a huge investment put into it. I don't mean to come down too harshly on Vex, but a 1600 I would think would know better than to waste a valuable TAC missile on an ACU that he had no chance in hell of killing. So hopefully he will see this and maybe take the lesson to heart and not do that. Always, always effectively use your mass investments. It is the best thing that you can do for yourself. Alright, speed 2. Has got his RAS, but not a RAS, I don't think. Well, he may. Yes, he does. He does have a RAS. So he is going for the T3 factory upgrade, just completed it, going to throw out a scout. And he's also going for a T3 mass extractor upgrade. He is up to 93 mass per tick, almost on par with Hellcat, and significantly outstripping his air opponent, Jack Harrer, who is only at 83. So that is a 10 mass per tick difference, which is about to get bigger, I think. Nope, 93 to 83. Alright. Actually, Jack Harrer is doing quite well for himself. I apologize, folks. I know not what is going on. Here comes the mass extractor, and bam, Jack Harrer. Nope. Speed 2 is still ahead, 116 to 106. So 10 mass lead there for speed. Let's take a look down here. We've got a bunch of Ilshivas engaging with some T1. Ilshiva is basically a walking point defense. Those are going to be able to demolish those T1 units. The Triads are going to be a little bit of a problem, but that accumulation of firepower is brutal when you have that many Ilshivas online. And honestly, I would be worried about my ACU at this point, because, oh, there's a beautiful overcharge. Lots of kills. Okay, Puck is going to be okay, I think. It is going to be a little bit hairy, but he does have one more Triad left, and he's got some units moving in. Cammer looks like he has I think he has regen. Let's pop over here to his ACU. Yes, first regen, T2, and gun upgrade. So he's going to get out fine. He does have some more Ilshivas left, and he's actually going to kill off the rest of OK Puck's units. And look at that regen already back up in the green, laying down overcharges on OK Puck, who does not have the gun upgrade. That is not going to be good. He's backing up. Does not have... I don't think he has the T2 build suite either. Nope, that is a totally unupgraded commander. Absolutely paper. So he has got to get back. He's doing a good job of doing that. Camera's going to camp right here and lay down some point defense. That means that he's going to get this whole reclaim field, and that's going to further advance his lead over his opponent. Ilshivas are going to start moving towards the back here. Hellcat has decided he's going to help out. He's going to throw some obsidians that way. The obsidians are going to do reasonably well versus the Ilshivas, not completely overpowering them on a one-to-one basis, but they are going to do well for themselves. So hopefully that'll put a damper on this stream of units coming back that OK Puck is having a little bit of a hard time dealing with at the moment. Nice little T2 engineer drop here. Speed 2 dropping this ledge, and I think that was a reclaim of that engineer. Scarecrow asking for mass. What is he building if he's asking for mass? He has got the T3. What did he just get? T2 RAS, that's what he's got. If you can get resource allocation without damaging your hold on the map or any of the upgrades that you deem vital to your gameplay, it does really help out the air player, because that is less power that they have to build. Nice job here getting these Ilshivas back. Crammer killing a T2 P-Gen, and probably could get one more, I think, if he stuck around. But he's going to try to kite around, going to take some fire from those Triads there, and those Ilshis are going to be lost. Nice little raiding over here with the gunship. Or not raiding, dealing with a unit that had gotten in. I think that was actually a landed air unit. Just caught it out of the corner of my eye when it was firing. Let's see here. That was a sad loss here. We've got the T3 HQ on the front line. And OK Puck is factory locked. That T1 artillery, you can see it's killing the unit as it starts to build. And that is going to be a terrible loss. Not really the best idea to have the T3 HQ that far out front. It is much better to build it back in the base. That way you don't lose your high tiers when your production on the front line gets overrun, as it will a lot of times. The game will flex back and forth as far as map control goes, although in this time it is more of a cascade than a fluctuation. And if you lose that HQ, you are screwed. He is laying down the T2 upgrade here without any assistance. Hopefully he can do something with it. T2 support. Is he going T3 support? Why is he going T3 support? That makes no sense whatsoever. You need the T3 HQ before you go T3 support, because then you won't be able to build any units. Alright, Corwin is under fire from a significant amount of Vipers. That's going to completely negate his ability to build any fire bases or get anything online. So well done from Scarecrow, playing a suppression game. And looks like he is just going to continue to stream trebuchets. And he does have some loyalists online there. Speed He's got some more air factories queued up along with a little bit of power. You want to keep that air production high because a T3 air advantage is a game winner in a lot of cases. Cammer not having a whole lot going on. At least back in the base. He does have some good build power up in the front. And he is, of course, progressing with his ACU. He's throwing up a TAC launcher. Brilliant. Nicely done, my good sir. The only bad thing is that there are some buzz kills in here. I don't know that he can get a TAC missile over top of that. But if he is able to kill one or more of these TMDs, he might have a chance of actually doing some real damage. And he is going to assist it with relatively good, excellent mass numbers. So he will be building those TACs at their maximum potential. Scarecrows, let's see, he's doing TMD. We got a T3 P-Gen coming online for Corwin. And Jack Hare looking like he has a very similar build to Speed in this regard. And that should not have been placed there. He may have intentionally abandoned that factory. And there's the GC, the inevitable T4 that we were going to see. Cannot have a pyramid game without at least a Monkey Lord. Alrighty then. And three GCs queued. Holy cow. Hellcat's already got four T3 mass extractors. Five T3 mass extractors. So he does have the eco to do this. Ah, there's the TAC launcher. Good use of it. He's going to kill that T2 mass extractor right there. As long as you're not wasting TACs on TMD covered locations, you're probably going to be okay. And if you see here, we've got another tactical missile launcher, or tactical missile defense that's been built. And if you count the TAC defense that's going to have to be built by the other people to cover this, they're probably going to spend more on TMD than Cammer did on the TAC launcher itself. So it's probably still worth it, even though he may not kill a lot. Trebuchet is going to move up. That's going to let them lay down a little bit of fire on these T1 tanks. Sorry, guys, I am yawning like crazy, and I don't know why. I'm not sleepy. I probably could have gotten more sleep last night, but for some reason, I just have an oxygen deficiency or something. Just wanting to yawn all over the place. Vex throwing down Ravagers, which is not the best idea, I think, because we do have a bit of a angle problem. You can see that a lot of the range advantage that the T3 point defense has is lost on the fact that there is a pyramid here. So, building a firebase more up this way and then covering it with only T2 point defense, I think would be just as viable a solution and would leave more mass left over to do other things with. Now, he is power stalling extremely hard. He's getting some upgrade on his chest. Probably personal shield. Maybe, maybe not. Start a GC I can support. Scarecrow wanting a T4 of his very own, or at least to help his team get one. Looks like that GC is finished. There it is right there. Walking to the right side. Going to try to reclaim some of the territory that was lost by OK Puck versus that is Cammer. And changing course a little bit. Not too much. Transport coming in to grab Cammer. ASF covering at the front. And transport is away. Alright, so Gray is safe. GC is not going to immediately kill anything off, but it is going to make its way back towards the base. If something is not done about it relatively soon, that GC may cause major problems. Burglar Bill. I don't know who that is. But very appropriate name for a Galactic Colossus. Alright, good bit of reclaim out there. Just kind of left out to dry. And Viper Push. I do hate Viper Push. Viper Push is incredibly annoying to get rid of, but it can be done. And my favorite tool for dealing with it is T1 Bomber Spam. If you can get T1 Bombers up enough to kamikaze into the TMLs with the Shift G split attack, You will actually be able to take out Vipers pretty effectively. Someone was also asking me the other day about the Shift G split attack. They said they could not get it to work. He just didn't do anything. And that is because if you're using Gaz UI, Shift G or the G key is already hotkeyed to something else. So what you're going to need to do is go to F1 and change the other hotkey away from G. Change it to something else, and you will then be able to use the split attack move. So if it wasn't working for you and you wondered what the hell everyone else was talking about because you were doing what everyone told you and it just didn't do anything, well, that's your problem. It's Gaz UI and it's a conflict of hotkeys. All right, Corrin falling back in the face of these bricks. Bricks are going to head over towards the base. There's an Otham online, but Othams are no match for bricks. There's also a half-built Yathotha, which is not going to do a whole lot. There are three bricks left. Four bricks left. Corwin does have the gun upgrade, and it looks like he has the... That's probably a T3 commander with a couple of veterancy as opposed to the regen commander. Let's take a look, see if we can find out. Yes. T3 with veterancy gives you the 20k health. With the gun upgrade and a couple of overcharges, he is easily going to dispatch that group of units. That's going to leave him free to push back a little bit. Well, we do have a Monkey Lord on the way. That may be somewhat problematic, although I think his ACU is tanky enough and long-ranged enough that it will actually be able to deal with that. We got our second GC online. Let's check on our first over here. He is killing Vex, or trying to. Vex, with that Commander Shield and the Ravager to help, I think it may have been better to actually try to overcharge the Galactic Colossus to death, especially since he's already got more Ravagers on the way over here. That's a close call. If his teammates can come and help him, he won't die if he continues to run away. And the GC's going to leave him. Okay, good deal. Vex making a clean getaway. Nothing to worry about here. Speed does have his GC online. That's going to head towards the front. Will probably be too late to save this base, though. There's only five Ravagers, two of which are not firing for some reason. And that GC is probably going to be able to kill everything before it becomes an issue. There's the turn. All of them are going to begin firing. One of them's already dead, and the shields are worn a little bit, so maybe. There we go. It's going to bite in. I think this GC is going to be fine, at least until this GC catches up. So you better start walking there, man. Don't want to sit in one spot too long. Alright, GC marching towards the front. That Monkey Lord was wisely brought back into the protection of the brick front line. There's also a Megalith going up with the help of Speed. That has got an awful lot of build power going into it, and a whole lot of mass. Mega was too much. maybe so. But if these trebuchets can land some hits, that GC is retreating. As long as the trebuchets can land a few hits and the bricks can be effective, shouldn't be too much of an issue. The pink Galactic Colossus, the oh-so-brilliant Hellcat possession, is going to be moving over to the left. Burglar Bill is in hot pursuit, but at the moment I don't think he's going to be able to catch it in time to do anything significant. There's going to be all that damage laid down. And I hear a chicken somewhere. I thought I heard the extremely distinct firing pattern of a Yathotha, but I may have been totally mistaken. Oh well. Probably was. That one is still building, but it is nowhere near coming out yet. It's going to pair these GCs up. It's going to be 2 versus 1. Yellow is retreating. Speed being very wise about that. Let's go ahead and bump the speed up just a little bit. It's getting a little bit stagnant as we're seeing people face off with multiple T4s. All those ASF trying to chase that one scout, which is then going to be shot down by some interceptors and a SAM, I think. Is there a SAM there? I think there's a SAM there. No, it was the interceptors. Cool beams. Not something you see every day. I always miss nukes on Canis. There's the strategic defense. Let me make sure there are no nukes. I don't think there are And check the southern side. Ah, perfect timing, Brink. There's your apocalypse. So we do have a nuke online. Hopefully Jack Herer can keep that beautifully balanced economy, because if he builds at max speed, I think he will beat speed to the defense loading. In fact, I'm sure he will, because he only has one T3 engineer building that defense, because he has not scouted that nuke. This could be a serious problem. There was a couple of scouts right there that got shot down. We got Gray with some scouts. These are going to get shot down, I think. As long as Jack Herer can prevent them from seeing this nuke launcher, which is already 20% loaded, he is going to have a game-winning strategy in his hands here, because there's not anything these bat guys are going to be able to do to stop him. All right, so we've got a Yathotha from the north. That belongs to Kammer. He was able to get that out, and he's got four shields accompanying it. Shields are always a good thing to send with your Yathotha. It has excellent damage, good area of effect, good firing pattern, but it does lack a little bit on health. It also has good rage. So, if you can pair the shields with your Yathotha, send them out front one by one to buy yourself 10k extra health in time, then the Yathotha actually becomes a fairly survivable unit. I apologize for starting to lose my voice, guys. This is my second cast back-to-back. I'm trying to knock out doubles on a few of these days so that I have casts for you guys to enjoy while I am away. But it does mean my voice may get a little bit rough in some of them. Fatboy is almost online here. That is going to be a good prevention method for all of these units coming in. Don't advance, though. You want to pull back. Don't let this thing die to the chicken. Wait for the GC. Let the GC deal with it, because the GC is going to fare much better versus that Yathotha. Percival's going to get shot point blank in the face with a fireball. Yathotha turning tail to run. It sees the fat boy. They see the GC following it up. No reason staying to fight. Need to just get out of there as quickly as possible. And Speed has his nuke up, and he is assisting it for all he's worth. Did they scout the nuke? Yes, they did. He sees that they have a nuke, but they do not know how long it has been built, and that thing is almost loaded. Let's see if we can admire Jack Herer's eco again. Yes, it is so pretty. It is beautiful. He's going to be able to dump that mass on some project or another relatively soon. Oh, stupid pause. Stop it. Okay, we're good now. He'll be able to dump it on something relatively soon. He just has to get that nuke loaded. If you mass stall at all, it exponentially slows the build rate of your nuke. And that GC's been given to OK Putt to micro with his Fat Boy. If you had the Fat Boy for support in a direct fire experimental such as the Galactic Colossus, which can pretty much go toe-to-toe with any of the others, that is a potent combination, because anything that you have to walk through normally with a GC, you can kill from range with a Fat Boy. And then the bane of the Galactic Colossus is existence, otherwise known as large quantities of T3, takes a huge amount of blanket damage from the Fat Boy in the rear. There is the nuke. See where that thing falls out is going to be dead in the middle of Speed's base. Not good, not good at all. Speed pulling his ASF out. He's got slightly less than Jack Herer already, and this is just going to be a nail in the coffin. Ouchie wawas. We've got four T4s on the left and two on the right. So six total for the southern team. But we have a substantial amount up here owned by Scarecrow. He needs to put these into use. He's got about 25 bricks or so, and he's got two megaliths and a monkey. There's the nuke. Let desolation rule the land, and it did not kill the nuke defense. Holy cow. That is a stroke of luck. I know, you don't talk about luck when you just had a nuke impact your base. But if there's one thing that you wanted to survive, it would be that nuke defense. Because it is almost loaded. So if that thing loads, that other nuke is going to be basically ineffective from that point on. So there's the range for that nuke defense. any nuke that comes in close enough to do any real damage to these bases is going to be denied. Now, these outlying bases, that is a whole nother story. Got a couple of valid targets here, especially if some units are in the area at that time. Galactic Colossus is going to have to pull back there. A Fat Boy coming up for Vex. That and the Ravager should be more than enough to discourage any entrance from these T4 units. This is going to be the bigger problem here. Two Megaliths is lethal. One is bad enough to deal with. It is expensive, yes, but it can deal with any other T4 without much problem. When you put two of them together, the damage and health is just so astronomical. It's well over 200,000 health to burn through, and a ludicrous amount of damage on a pretty dang good range to boot from those Megaliths. So it's just a pain. That's all it is. It is a pain to deal with. I'm going to bump the speed back up here. I need to both get this over with time-wise and also try to save what is left of my voice. Got a Fat Boy that just got started and they decided against it. Speed is getting that T3 HQ back online as quickly as he possibly can. He's got to get T3 engineers out. That is critical. And so many pings. Holy cow. Stop! Stop! Alright. So the T3 engineers were being pinged. Camera asking for an engineer. And it looks like Vex is going to go to war with his Fat Boy. He's extending his shield coverage as he goes. That is actually a pretty reasonable tactic. And he's going to park and build another Fat Boy. Fat Boys are another unit that really compound damage. One Fat Boy can be dealt with and is not necessarily that terrifyingly bad. And that is going to be a failed nuke. There is a defense well within reach. But multiple Fat Boys just have such high damage for their mass worth. And even though they're inaccurate, they do more blanket damage than they do single target damage. Once you get two or three Fat Boys stacked on top of each other, there's just not much that can live against that. Because if you have two or three Fat Boys, you may or may not have enough AoE to damage all three Fat Boys. The other factions, the Athotha has area of effect and the Megalith has area of effect, and you may hit two Fat Boys, but not all three. And with the Athotha, the only cannon that does have enough area of effect, I can't talk. The only shot that has enough area of effect to actually hit all three shields is only a small portion of the total damage of the unit. Whereas if you send three T4s versus three Fat Boys, the Fat Boys' area of effect is so massive that more than likely they're going to be damaging two or all three of those T4s the entire time. So stacked Fat Boys just become more and more damaging at the more units that you get, until it's basically just a wall of artillery shells that advances and there's nothing that you can do to stop it unless you go in with airstrikes or something. Or a nuke. Nukes work as well. Now, what's scaring me every bit as much as the three megaliths on the front of this is the sheer number of bricks in the back. Look at the health falling off of that Galactic Colossus. Holy cow, that thing died in just a matter of seconds. And the march of the megalith carries on. That is exactly what you don't want to do, is stand still with the YOLO. You want to run it in as fast as you possibly can to drop that lightning storm in close and suicide in the middle of the unit so the lightning does as much damage as possible. You do not ever want to stop walking. And yes, I did say YOLO. I am ashamed of it after I said it, but it is kind of a hilarious nickname for the chicken. Because, yeah, most of the time the missions that they go on are suicide missions, just realistically speaking. So we've got three Galactic Colossuses hitting all of these bricks, and it's going to do a bit of damage, but not nearly enough. And we've already got two more Galactics down to half health or lower. Those Megaliths are just wailing on them. That's going to be another Galactic Colossus down right there. The flames pouring from its reactor, and it's going to take a knee and then a faceplant. And I think that one right there is going to... Nope. It's going to survive. There's yet another GC coming in from the back and another chicken being built. But 3 megaliths and a fat boy, 4 megaliths and a fat boy, Scarecrow is just determined to plow this side under. Holy cow, how did he get the eco to do that? He's pulling 315 per tick off of almost half the map under his control on this side. Well, let's say a third. He's got a third of the map under his direct control, pulling all of the mass from it, and only 11,000 reclaim, which is actually kind of sad. Let's see where this nuke is headed. Directly for the T4s. That's going to take out all the bricks, at least. This megalith, that monkey lord. Boom! Beautiful shot! Nicely done. Down to 3 megaliths, about to be 2 megaliths, and we got 2 GCs online. Just live long enough to kill it. We're good. I thought that was going to be the end of the game right then and there, but apparently not. Holy cow, look at the mass field, though. All that mass out there. Still some crabs walking in. They are far from out of trouble, but it does look better than it did a minute ago. I can't say that much. And here comes another megalith. Speed pouring all of his eco into this thing as well. Holy kishmolies. If you can't win with air, win with land. My goodness. So much mass being dumped into that. I cannot remember. See, this mod, I'm going to be relying on this mod constantly now. So we've got 37,000 mass. For 4 megaliths, that is 150,000 mass at once on the table, which is just huge, huge mass numbers. That is pushing up on Paragon or Maver numbers, except that they need the combat ability to stay in the game. You can't dump all of that mass into one target, because then you would not have anything left to defend yourself with. Fat Boy's going online for OK Puck, people trying to get some assistance out up here. There are a couple of Rambo comms, but those died pretty quickly, and that is about to go Lightning Storm in the base. Reclaim it! Reclaim it! Don't let it die. If you reclaim the Athathas, you can actually negate the Lightning Storm. Lightning Storm does not kick in if the unit's being reclaimed when it dies. Pro tip, maybe even enough to get the to merit having your ACU directly next to the Athatha when it dies. I know that's kind of counterintuitive because you're always, oh no, Lightning Storm, but you don't have a Lightning Storm to deal with if you're reclaiming it. Got a GC making a beeline for the bases here. Hellcat pushing Rambo comms like there's no tomorrow. And a couple of more Rambo comms coming up from OK Puck. Those three together are going to be able to kill that GC. Shouldn't have stopped walking, but Speed, I think that may have been a mistake. If you could have walked in a little further, might have gotten a T3P gen or two at least, but as it is, that's just going to die without really doing much. And still 2 megaliths. Fat Boy's down. Thank goodness. There is Strap Bombers online, and there's another nuke. Where's that headed? Where's that headed? Well, that wasn't the best target ever. I probably would have nuked here, because there's a lot of build power as T3 Engineer, TAC launchers, some T2 mass extractors. I don't know. Maybe even that. Whatever. The nuke is going to strike some things and it is going to reduce the overall eco of the other team, so I guess it's not a total loss. That Lightning Storm is paying for herself. Just sapping the health away from the Megalith. Strap Bombers coming in left, right, and center from both of these players. Both of them building nothing but Strap Bombers. You can see them coming online. Megalith trying to kill the power. As I've said before, power is the most critical resource in the endgame, because once you hit a certain point, and I know that we've hit that point by now. Overcharge, Commander, there. Need to be using the overcharge. Once you hit a certain point in the game, there's basically infinite mass. You can reclaim all the mass you want. There is 200,000 mass in this pile of wrecks here. And you have to have power to spend it, though. That's the key. You have to have power to be able to spend your reclaim, to spend the mass that you're building. T3 artillery coming up. Nice. They're going to be able to build that no problem. Typically on a 10k map, I would say, hell no, don't build that T3 arty. That is going to lose the game for you. But when you have a that big of a supply of masks right on your doorstep, by all means, build the T3 Arty. It is a method of not overflowing masks to throw too much build power on that thing. And that T3 Arty is going to be able to easily kill off all of that. Scarecrow's going up. No! That was the main line land player. All the bricks, all the build power, all the megaliths. They are out of here. Air has been destroyed. Jack Harrer owning speed 2 on that. There goes the left side. T3 Arty is going to come online in a second. There is a nuke. It is not loaded. Strap Bomber's going to kill that pretty easily. I think that may be game. Holy cow, that was a turnaround. I was not expecting that. I was looking at this, the slow game, the slow progression into disintegration of the Southern team. They lost the right side. Blue folded almost all the way back to his base. Red folded all the way back to his base. Scarecrow just had so many megaliths. My goodness. But Jack Harrer pulled it out. He is definitely MVP. Everybody did their part. Hellcat built a lot of GCs, held mid very well, had huge eco, and was definitely one of the reasons that the map didn't completely fold. But in the end, Jack Harrer, that brilliant nuke on the T4s, getting rid of all those bricks. The bricks were a huge problem. Nuking speed early on in the game that removed a lot of the air problems that they were having. And then just owning the remaining air and using strap bombers to clean everything up. I think Jack Harrer definitely made the game on this one. And that was against a rank disadvantage. Well done there, bud. Well done. Fatboy's going to go up. We got another ACU nuke that was probably green. I wasn't paying too much attention. I saw the strap bombers. Yes, Vex is gone. Another ACU toasty fried. That leaves gray and yellow, seeing if they can get anything online, and I don't know that they can. There is the T3 artillery online. It is firing shots at the base over here. Strap bombers are going to start coming in. T3 air OP, rename on the commander. Well, it's only OP if you lose air control. That's all I got to say. If you can get enough SAMs online, a fairly significant amount of SAMs, you can deny T3 air. I will admit that it's probably one of the strongest things in the game and maybe the cheesiest to win by, but I don't know. There is a trifecta to balance. There is land, air, and navy. And if you nerf air, then navy is going to be overpowered. And if you buff navy, then the entire map is just going to blow up in your face because navy is going to be so overpowered, it's ridiculous. And then land is just a whole nother story. So balance is tricky. I think it's in a reasonably good spot right now. The only complaint that I have is that early T3 air kills off the entire map. It's early T3 air that's the problem, not T3 air in general. There's just such a huge gap in the tiers. T3 over T2 air is just a ridiculous difference, and then you can't really kill strap bombers unless you have either T3 mobile anti-air or a SAM or a large number of Swift Winds or a few ASF. You're very limited in your options, and sometimes it's hard to pull off. And I'm rambling again. While the map is folding up under my commentary, I am rambling about something totally unrelated, but hopefully you learned something, hopefully. It will promote a good discussion of what should be happening in the game. As a lot of you know, oh, there goes the commander. He is going to suicide into the ASF. I just know it. Yep, that is exactly what he's doing. As you guys know, TA for Life got nominated to be the player counselor. He took his position just recently. Poof, go the ASF. So that is going to clean up some of the ladder pool. He is going to have a hand in that, and that's going to help out what's going on in the FAF client. And then a balance counselor should be chosen relatively soon. So make sure you keep an ear out, tab into the What's New. Use the What's New tab occasionally to see what's going on and if there's a poll up for a counselor position at any point. And just kind of keep tabs on that. And hopefully we can make this game even better than it already is. It is probably one of the best balanced strategy games that I've ever played, ever, even though there are some complaints. Most of them are relatively minor, and it is a really good place right now. I think the only things that need attention are the TAC launcher for Seraphim Commander, the UEF Rambo Comms, and early T3 Air would be my picks. Other than that, it's pretty dang good. Looks like we got a second T3 artillery up. Did we? Yep, we did, right there. So two T3 artillery wailing away at that. And that was a successful nuke defense. There's two loaded there, and we have a broken artillery shot right there in our view. That's okay, though. It's like an eye floater. RamboCom going up. And just waiting on him to die. Here come the strap bombers. Maybe that will do it. I don't think so, though. Oh, it was close. Nuke defense is down. That's the important thing. Here comes the artillery shots. Boom, boom. Direct impact. There goes the commander. That is game. GG all around. Well played by these guys. Scarecrow with his ridiculous T4 and Jack Hare with that brilliant comeback to win the game. That was... That I did not expect that outcome. That was a total surprise to me. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this game. And as always, thank you so much for watching all of these casts. I have a great time bringing them to you. And hopefully when I come back, we can jump into this full force again at the beginning of June. I would encourage you guys, a lot of you know that I have a Patreon account. Down in the description, there's a link to that. If you enjoy the videos and you feel like supporting me, I would greatly appreciate it. It does help me out a lot. And in addition to that, I am starting to do... I have two or three more tutorials that I want to do that will wrap up my tutorial series on, you know, Navy, Air, Land, Factions, all of that. And then I want to get back into doing games for you guys. And that is actually going to be a Patreon reward. If you're supporting at the $5 tier, if you donate $5 a month, you get a replay analyzed. You can send me a replay of a game that you lost or won, team game, one versus one, anything that happens as long as the replay is around 30 minutes or less. You can send it in to me and I will do a full analysis of your gameplay and hopefully help you out with that. And so that's at the $5 tier, and then there's another one above that for those of you who are extremely generous. And again, I do greatly, greatly appreciate that. You guys have no idea how much all of this benefits me personally. How much I get out of this community is an amazing thing, and I am eternally grateful. Alrighty, guys, I'm going to stop rambling. As always, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next cast.